Welcome to Hot Seat Extra. I am Akintayo Aditukumbo. Our guest in this edition is a Zimbabwean politician. Until 2002, he was the Minister of Finance and Economic Development in President Robert Mugabe's cabinet. As a rising star within the ranks of President Mugabe's administration, he was first appointed Deputy Minister of Agriculture in 1980, same year Zimbabwe gained its independence. In early 2000, he faced strong opposition during the economic change in Zimbabwe as his economic policies, according to the rest of his then ruling ZANU-PF party, was contradictory. And in 2008, after a failed attempt to replace Robert Mugabe in the ZANU-PF Congress, he stood for presidential election against the incumbent President Mugabe. With fragmentations within the main political factions in Zimbabwe, he now leads Mavambo opposition political party, with which he intends to challenge the ZANU-PF again in the polls to the Oval Office. Dr. Simba Makoni, welcome to HOTSEAT XTRA.
Thank you.
Yeah, you've got a wonderful profile. You joined the Mugabe government in 1980 at the age of 30. And a year later, you became Minister for Industry and Energy Development until 1983. Therefore, within the 3 years, you were at the top in Mugabe's inner circle. What did you see that went so bad that you're now opposing the very government that you helped to set up?
Well, I think we want to understand the evolution of Zimbabwe in stages. The first 15 years of our independence were very good. Mm. We had progress, development, and the quality of life of the people was improving. The government and its functionaries, in particular the president who at that time was prime minister, were sensitive to and responsive to the needs of the people. We remained close to the people. In the latter part of the 1990s into the 2000s, the situation changed. Primarily, the management of our national economy into the 90s deteriorated, the economy contracted, jobs were being lost, young people, highly educated, highly skilled, were not finding places to apply their skills and to earn a living. And disenchantment set in, which grew into open protests by labor movement, by civil society organizations. First food riots we had in 1997 and 1998, accompanied by two currency crashes. We call them Black Fridays, November 97, November 98. And the slippery road to economic collapse, accompanied then by intolerance, oppression, and you could see the beginning of the abuse of human rights in an effort to secure and protect our position in power.
Yeah, but Zimbabwe used to be the food basket of Africa, and now you're relying on food aid. What could have gone wrong? The rains are still there, you're not suffering drought, and Zimbabwe has one of the best weather for food production in Africa. What went wrong?
Again, the evolution of the collapse of systems, particularly operating functional systems of the economy, leading to the hyperinflation of the late 90s into the early 2000s, meant that farmers could no longer procure inputs for production. They could no longer procure financial facilities, loans for seasonal planting of crops, and the distribution and marketing not only of crop inputs but of produce, little that was no longer available. And so therefore the support systems that encouraged small-scale rural farmers in Zimbabwe to produce surpluses that made us the breadbasket are no longer available today, and that's why we're in food deficits.
Yeah, but it's like, could also the eviction of white farmers could have led to all these problems as well?
No, in respect of the staple food production, I don't believe so. Because mind you, by 1996, small-scale rural farmers, we call them communal farmers, accounted for 80% of all commercially traded maize in Zimbabwe, including the surpluses that were exported to neighboring countries. Those farmers did not have their land taken away. They were not resettled, and therefore the food self-insufficiency that we are encountering at the moment is not principally on account of the land reform program. It's on account of the collapse of the agriculture support services to rural black farmers.
Yeah, but could it be that resources, financial resources dried up for the government, that's why they couldn't provide all those resources they used to give to farmers in the past?
Well, the question is, why would those resources dry up? But the one issue we need to clarify is that at the time when we were highly productive, the government wasn't issuing out grants to farmers. Farmers could organize facilities in the market. There were loans given by an agricultural bank. Yes, it was a state bank called the Agricultural Finance Corporation, but they weren't handouts by government. Farmers were not receiving handouts of seeds and fertilizers and chemicals like we then tried to do at the time when the government could not afford it. So it was the collapse because of inappropriate policies of the workings of a very efficient market that supported a highly productive rural farmer that accounts for the fact that we are no longer a food basket.
Yeah, but could it be inappropriate policies that made you to move out of the mainstream of the ZANU-PF?
It's part of the story. There are a number of issues that make up the story why I moved out. Certainly the fact that what we were doing was hurting the people. We were so preoccupied with keeping our power and we forgot the purpose of being in office is to serve the people.
But wouldn't you see it as an African politics thing? Like, because it happens in so many African countries that the incumbent doesn't want to move out.
Yes, but is that justification for perpetuation? Some of us have got to take a stand and say enough is enough. African politicians must know there's a time to come and there's a time to go.
Yeah, but did you ever have the opportunity to tell President Mugabe this?
I had opportunity to work within ZANU-PF. For a long time, I was involved in efforts to make change from within ZANU-PF. A very, very long time with many, many other comrades in ZANU-PF. It was only when I realized making change from within wasn't coming that I decided to leave.
Okay, still talking about your movement from the ZANU-PF, you've held several high positions. You were the executive secretary of SADC, that is the Southern African Development Community, and you denied wrongdoing in the 1993 $25,000 scam in the organization, which saw three financial officers dismissed, and they implicated you in that scam. Do you think there is a problem even with your own personal managerial skills?
Well, the first thing we must establish are the facts. I was executive secretary of SADC. I personally did not do anything involved in what you're calling a scam. The investigations that were conducted by SADC authorities confirmed that. But because I was the chief executive of the organization, I took responsibility for the actions of my staff. So I think that is what any leader and every leader of integrity and honesty is expected to do.
But why did they have to implicate you? Were they doing something?
I don't know what you mean by implicate you, but like I'm saying, the facts that I know are that the investigations confirmed that the executive secretary was not involved in the goings-on in that so-called scam, but that the executive secretary, when the report was presented, and I went to the Council of Ministers and I said to the Council of Ministers, because these things were happening under my authority by people who were accountable and responsible to me, I accept that I have culpability and responsibility for the conduct of my staff. The measures that were taken, including the dismissal of those staff, were taken by me as chief executive of the organization. So I think we want to make a clear distinction, and I have nothing to hide here. Everything is very open and in the public domain. At that time, the report of the investigating team was made public. People did things who were working under me, and if you're the chief executive of an organization, the president of a country, the buck stops with you, and you must accept that responsibility.
Okay, let's go back to the inner workings of President Mugabe's administration. You supported the devaluation of the Zimbabwean policy as a finance minister, a policy that was not favored by your boss then. That's talking about President Mugabe. But do you regret the decision to devalue the Zimbabwean dollar?
I think we want to place the devaluation of the dollar into a context. We had a package of measures that we called the Millennium Economic Development Program, which covered various aspects of the functioning and management of our economy. Within that program were activities relating to the exchange rate management, monetary policy and exchange rate management. And within the exchange rate management measures was the value of the currency. So it was a government program. I was steering it because I was Minister of Finance and Economic Development, but the Millennium Economic Recovery Program was approved by government. It carried the preface and signature of Robert Mugabe as President of Zimbabwe. So I was implementing not a personal program of Simba Makoni, I was implementing a program of the government of Zimbabwe under the auspices of Robert Mugabe. And if Robert Mugabe behaved like me in the so-called scam case you talk about, he was the chief executive, he would have accepted ultimate responsibility for the Millennium Economic Recovery Program.
Okay, and I'm happy you mentioned the issue of the scam and Mugabe behaving like you. Could it be his problem? It's because everything going wrong in Zimbabwe is about Robert Mugabe. Even when people are asking for asylum in the UK, they say Robert Mugabe, even a 10-year-old girl will come to the UK and say, Robert Mugabe is chasing me. Could that be the problem he's having, that not having a hold on the inner workings of his administration?
You know, I think we must focus our attention on the institutions and processes. Mugabe is president of Zimbabwe. He's the chief executive of Zim Incorporated. Things are done ultimately on account of, by omission or by commission, of the chief executive. So if human rights are being abused by agents of state for which you are the chief executive, you must accept final responsibility. It may not be, and it is not even, that every action is done on Mugabe's direct command, but it is done under the auspices of his authority. And it is your responsibility to stop evil being done under your authority and to promote good to be done under your authority.